Next is how the occlusion would be in the mixed dentition. Now the mixed dentition, we also refer to it as the transitional dentition, which occurs usually is seen between the 6 years or to 12 years of age. Okay. Now, in the mixed dentition, there are few very important changes which are there are occurring, which will again have a profound impact on the type of occlusion which is going to develop in the permanent dentition. Now, what are these changes? We will be discussing about that under this fourth heading, that is the arch dimension, changes in the arch dimension and the sizes of the tooth, increase in the width of the arch, and the differences in between the sizes of the primary and the erupting permanent teeth, and lastly the incisal liability. Okay. Now first, we will start with the arch dimensions and the tooth size. Now, as you know that in the mixed dentition period means, now the permanent teeth have started to erupt. Now, what is the problem as we have discussed that the permanent teeth are larger in overall dimensions as compared to that of the primary teeth. Okay. Now, to accommodate this teeth, the jaws have to increase in the size. So, how the jaws increase? How will they increase in the anterior-posterior direction? Okay. The jaws will accommodate this larger size permanent teeth by increasing in the anterior-posterior direction. But apart from that, then there are certain other factors which also will help in accommodating the larger size permanent teeth. The next factor is the incisors. If you see the primary incisors, they are almost upright. But when you see the permanent incisors, they are more proclinated. They have an anterior-posterior rotation. This rotation saves at least 2 to 3 millimeter space in per quadrant. So that space is again utilized for developing the class 1 type of relationship. Okay. Then another thing is less the another point is that what we call as Leeway space of nerves. That is, there is a difference in the width of the primary molars and that of the base. Primary molars are wider as compared to that of the premolars, so that whatever space is gained by that is again utilized to go into the class 1 type of relationship. Okay. Now, if any changes occur, if this particular spaces are not there, or if the tooth size which is erupting is much larger than the jaw size, then it is going to cause crowding in the teeth. That permanent teeth won't get the enough space to come into a proper location or in proper direction, or they might not be having, will not get the space to get angulated themselves in a favorable angle. That point is very important. Remember that teeth are teeth. If you leave the mandibular incisors, almost all of them are angulated. Even mandibular incisors are angulated, but their angulations are less. Whereas all other teeth, they are very much angulated in various directions. If these angulations are very important, because only then they will be functioning properly. Only then they can bear the occlusal limits. Okay. So that is why eruption of them in the required space is very important. Now in this schematic diagram, I have just tried to show how the jaw is increasing in the anterior posterior direction. This is the primary dentition. Now see that once the first molar has started to erupt, then you can see the profound increase in the anterior posterior direction. Now this is the schematic diagram showing the difference in the mesiodistal dimension of the primary molars and that of the premolars. Now, arch width. Now, as we know that the permanent teeth are larger than the primary teeth, so to accommodate them, the arch has to be the width of the arch has to be increased. So, usually during the period of the 7 to 15 years, the arch width gets increased. The intercanine width gets increased by around 2.5 to 3 mm. Okay. Now, those persons who are having the transpalatal width, that is the width from the buccal cusp of right canine to the buccal cusp of the left canine, if it is less than 31 mm, usually in the mixed dentition period, then it is considered that that particular person won't be having a proper U-shaped arches. Arches would be more of a V-shape, and that's why chances of him or her developing a class 1 type of relationship would be lesser. In such cases, we can initiate this treatment in the earlier stages by increasing the, there are many appliances which will increase the palatal width. Now, coming to the third point, that is the differences in the size of the tooth. Now, this is what we call as the leeway space of gums. As you must have gone through the exam paper, this is very commonly asked essentially. Now, leeway space of gums is nothing but the difference between the erupting premolars and the medial dimension of the primary molars which these premolars are replacing. Okay. The total size of the premolars on an average is around 42.2 millimeters, whereas the total size, medial distal width of the primary molars is around 47 millimeters. So, in general, in both, we get around 4.8 mm of space, which is called as leeway space of gums. Okay. So, this space is utilized for the mesial shift of the lower molar. You remember that early mesial shift. There is another term that is called as late mesial shift. I will be talking about shortly about that. Now, this mesial shift of the mandibular molars is very important because then only it is will allow the maxillary molar to directly erupt into the class 1 type of relationship. Remember that if the maxillary molar doesn't erupt into the class 1 type of relationship, then it would be very difficult for that particular person to have a favorable class 1 inclination because permanent teeth have a very strong and prominent cusp. So once they get occluded, even in the wrong position, it would be difficult for them to alter themselves and come to the favorable position. Now, what is the significance of this leeway space? It, as I told you, it will allow the mesial movement of the permanent molar, especially the mandibular molar, so that the maxillary molar will erupt in a proper position. They allow the flush terminal plane to correct the any alterations which are there in the flush, any mesial step or distal step occur in the flush terminal plane. Then, the space of this leeway space is used to get transformed into the class 1 type of relation. Some of this space can also be used to alleviate the crowding which is usually seen in the mandibular incisors, especially when, at the time of the eruption. So, some of the, some amount of space is also utilized to reduce that particular crowding. Okay. Now, this is the reason why in we always say that the primary molars should be saved, they should not be extracted or they should be, because they act as the best space maintainer. They maintain the space. If the primary molars are exfoliated early, this leeway space is lost. The mandibular molar will move far more mesially than it will, the occlusion it would be developing would be having more of a mesial state and going towards the class 3 type of occlusion. Another SAQ which is commonly asked on this chapter is the incisal liability. Incisal liability means the difference between the size, which has to be provided by the growth of the jaws. Okay. Now, incisal liability, now if you compare the mesiodistal dimension of the incisors in permanent dentition with that of the primary dentition, the permanent dentition incisors are much larger as compared to that of the primary dentition. Okay. Now, this overall, this liability, in case of the maxillary jaw, it is around 7 millimeters. In case of the mandibular jaw, because the incise, permanent incisor and mandible are smaller, so it is around 5 millimeters. Now, how this incisal liability is taken care of? The most important point, how it is taken care by, is so whatever interdental spaces were there, which are present in the deciduous dentition, they all are, all that space is utilized for the extra width of the permanent teeth. Second thing is increase in the intercanine width by the anterior posterior growth of the jaw. Third point, which is the most important point, is by changing in the incisor inclination. Remember that the primary incisors, they are almost straight, upright, whereas the permanent incisors, they are more proclinated. Why they are proclinated? Because as they go out of the arch, they take up less amount of space. So, whatever that incisal liability was there, it is taken care of. So, there won't be any crowding in that particular area. Now, coming to the late mesial shift. Now, late mesial shift is similar to that of the early mesial shift. In both this shift, what happens is the mandible, mandibular molars move mesially so that the maxillary molar will erupt directly into the class 1 type of relationship. Okay. Early mesial shift, when it is possible, when there are spaces in the jaw. When there are not enough spaces in the jaw, then usually what happens in the, we call it as the late mesial shift. In this, what happens is that because the arches are having no space, when the primary molars will get exfoliated, at that time, the mandibular molar, the permanent mandibular molar will move mesially. Plus, it will utilize the leeway space, whatever was there. So, why this movement is called as late? Because it is occurring after the shading of the primary teeth. That's why it is considered as the late mesial shift. So, once the primary teeth are shaded, the mandibular molars will move into the mesial direction. This will allow the permanent maxillary molar to erupt directly.